You already know what time it is. Welcome back into the What Offseason Sports Podcast, everybody. Coming on today's episode, guys, the NBA season is right around the corner. Really, I almost said kicking off because I've been talking so much football. Really tipping off in the next couple of days. And I'm coming at you with six bold predictions. Some of these are really hot. Some of these you might agree with, but we'll see once we get into the episode for the 2021 NBA season coming up. But I'm not alone today. I've got Tony Tucker, a great guy that's always engaging with my content on Instagram, runs a show of his own as well. Tony, introduce yourself to the people today, man.
What up, everybody? My name's Tony Tucker, Project Drivel. Check me out, Instagram, YouTube, Twitter, all that fun stuff. I'm ready to talk some hoops, man. Let's do it.
Yeah, man, absolutely. And of course, as always, thank you so much for coming on the show. Anybody that's listening, of course, you can go check out Tony Tucker at Project Drivel so you can see all his social media handles. And of course, never forget to check the link tree in the bio of every social media page What Offseason has. It's every bit of content that we're putting out for you. Tony, I'll start with you, man. Give me a bold prediction you got coming up for the 2021 NBA season.
So the first one I want to start with is we've all seen what's going on with James Harden and the Houston Rockets.
Oh, yes.
And we have a guy who's getting 34 points a game last year. There's no way that this team shouldn't make the playoffs, and they're not going to make the playoffs this year. The Houston Rockets are – I'm not sure – if Harden will get traded or if he'll just be checked out and hanging out with a little baby all the time and won't be in attendance enough, you know, breaking COVID protocols so that he can make his honey bun run. I feel bad for Silas. He's finally getting a shot in the show and he's getting a malcontent James Harden, MVP candidate James Harden in his first season. So the Rockets missed the playoffs and it's really going to open things up in as far as like who those other teams that are getting into the West and making it a little more interesting. So having a guy that's gone from MVP to no playoffs, I'm not sure we've seen a fall really like this in a long time. You know, like maybe if you look back at like an Allen Iverson or something when he left Philly to go to Denver, although I think the Denver team still made the playoffs, but I don't see Harden being able to be focused and stay engaged in Houston with everything that I'm reading right now, talking like right. Miami or the Bucks or this team or that. Like, he's like, I just want to go anywhere. Like, I'm literally waiting for him to say, like, Ice Cube, can I get in your big three? Like, he right. just wants out of Houston.
That is really, really bold there, saying that the Rockets won't make the playoffs. But I totally understand where you're coming from in that aspect. You look at a guy like James Harden, where you go through so many players with a superstar that's still with the franchise, and eventually you start to look, okay, is it the coach? Okay, is it the players? You want to talk about him potentially losing focus and just really not being able to be all there. A guy that is putting up points, though, but you want to talk about a drop-off that could be coming. I got to say that's super bold, man. The Houston Rockets completely missing the playoffs. You're going to see Golden State back in there, of course, with Steph Curry. He's coming back from the injury. No Klay Thompson, but I do think that the Warriors are actually going to be a lot more formidable and a lot better than people think this year. And then you look at the Mavericks holding the best young player. Yes, better than Zion Williamson, the best young player in the NBA in Luka Doncic. Got a bold prediction coming for him later on in the episode, yeah. But I absolutely love that. Man, if you had to say on a scale of 1 to 10, how bold do you think that would be for the NBA season? Drop it on me, man.
For me, this is probably like a 5 because of all of the turmoil that's going on, right? So it's like, because if they trade him, then they're probably not making the playoffs, right? Like, even if they get, like, let's say they make the move to Philadelphia and they get Simmons or Embiid or something like that, and a Tobias Harris thrown in there, that team's not making the playoffs in the West, not trying to figure it out with John Wall and putting it together. So I would have it at a 5 based on the fact that I'm basing this prediction around Harden probably not even finishing the season with the Rockets.
Yeah, that's huge. And I'd honestly say about a 5 or a 6 as well. It wouldn't necessarily be surprising if James Harden did leave, because we're hearing about all these teams potentially that he could go to. And I feel like James Harden is kind of piggybacking on what Kevin Durant just did going to Brooklyn. KD wanted to be the next man up so bad. He went and got himself a couple of rings, got himself a couple of finals MVPs, was absolutely balling with Golden State. But when he left from OKC to go to Golden State, he did want to be that dude, but he knew it wasn't going to happen with the three that was already there. He was just a luxury. They didn't need KD, and everybody knows that. But him going to the Nets, we can see how he wants to be that guy. And I feel like Harden is kind of continuing to maybe chase that status, because you see him go from OKC over to the Rockets to be the number one man, no question. And now he wants out again. Maybe something to do with the culture in Houston. I don't necessarily know, but I definitely got to agree with you. Probably about a 5 for me as well on the boldness scale. Guys, I'm starting off hot in this episode. My first bold take for the 2021 NBA season. I'm going to come out and say it first, and then I'm going to back it up for you. Giannis Antetokounmpo does not play up to the worth of his contract this year, and here's why. You look at Giannis signing the contract, largest deal in NBA history. It's been all around the news the past few days. We've all seen it. Back-to-back MVPs. Could he maybe go for 3 in a row? That would be absolutely insane. Well-deserved money, though. 2 years in a row in the NBA, the best record. And people say he's potentially up next after LeBron in terms of stardom, being the face of the NBA. You do have guys like Luka and potentially Zion competing with him. But the reason I say that he doesn't potentially play up to the worth of his contract this year, this man is going to be making $40 million next year, 39.1. We'll go ahead and say 40. But on an average of $45.6 million, we've all seen the numbers. You look, he goes from 39 to 42 to 45 to 48 to basically 52 in the 25 to 26 season. That is a lot of money for a guy. With this type of money, man, it feels like it's got to be championship or bust, and I don't necessarily know if I see the Bucks going to the title this year. You look at the Heat, that really shocked everybody. I think Boston is potentially going to come back better. There's guys in the East that can play, and then you look at the Western competition, they're obviously going to have to go face. I do think the Lakers are the favorites to repeat, but you see the one Eastern Conference appearance, injured and knocked out in round 2 last year, so that was kind of tough for them. That's why I didn't necessarily agree with the MVP, and I know the guy got hurt, but that's why I've always been an advocate of hand out the MVP after the season is over. And I just feel like this is potentially, like I said, an instance where he just doesn't play or live up to the hype, because it kind of feels like a form of championship or bust in Milwaukee. I know Mike Budenholzer definitely, Coach Bud does not want to admit that. And some people maybe even potentially say that Coach Bud is on the hot seat if he does not get to the finals and win one here, Sue, with Giannis, especially after backing up a Brinks truck. Do you think potentially Giannis could not live up to the worth of his contract this year?
Adam, I love this prediction. And I had something similar to this before he inked that deal today.
Right.
We're looking at a guy, when he got injured in that game, Chris Middleton came in and they won their only game in that series last year.
Literally.
Without him, didn't they? Like, so Budenholzer is doing this thing where he's like, oh, we're not actually, this isn't championship or bust. But hey, coach, if you guys don't win, they're going to be looking to throw somebody under the bus to keep Giannis happy at the end of the season.
Yep.
And he's going to be the sacrificial lamb. He'll be gone. To me, Giannis signing this deal. Everybody, I'd like to let you know, Giannis is the new Patrick Ewing in the East, because Ooh. He's maybe going to get to an NBA final, one of them.
Right.
He's going to be a great player. It's great for the league that he's staying in Milwaukee, because it'll make it competitive.
Of course.
But when the playoffs come, we have not seen him take that step that LeBron did, where he evolved his ability to move outside and be a threat. Until that is an actual threat,
definitely,
they are not going to be worried about Giannis, because he doesn't play great with his back to the basket, which is another element that LeBron added to his game when he was in Miami.
Right.
And if Harden goes to Milwaukee to chase rings, like sort of what you were mentioning, what Durant did with Golden
Right.
State, then we could definitely see getting a title then. But the way the roster is constructed right now, we're looking at the mid-90s Knicks with Ewing and Allen Houston and John Starks. Like, this roster will be good in the regular season.
Of course.
And the postseason will come, and better coaching and better defense, team defense will take over, and he will not live up to the $40 million.
I definitely love that take there, man. And you look at another thing. Giannis has yet to develop the jump shot. There's no question that he's arguably the best player at the rim in the NBA. Go look at his numbers. Minutes, points, rebounds, steals, assists. Everything's been going up for him. Field goal percentage. The guy was, you know, shooting for 30 points from the field last year. I mean, we know the baller that Giannis is. We've seen the back-to-back MVPs. You want to talk about an insane story. And I love what Giannis is trying to do here, because he could easily say, yeah, send me to Miami. Yeah, send me to LA. Yeah, send me to one of these big NBA cities. cities or send me to a bad team potentially, like KD kind of went to get that number one role, or you stay where you are, you stay with the organization that took a chance on you. And I feel like potentially staying here in Milwaukee, I love the allusion to keeping it competitive and really just wanting to stay with his roots. That could really help his dynasty and just his, not dynasty, wrong word there, his legacy in general, staying with a team like Milwaukee, who hasn't necessarily been anything, you know, after they had their runs in the earlier days. So with Giannis doing this, I absolutely love the big signing. But like I said, I just don't think Giannis plays up to the worth of his contract this year. It's championship or bust for the Bucks. Two straight years in the NBA, the best record. It is championship or bust this year for Giannis and Coach Bud. Scale of 1 to 10, actually, man, what would you say the boldness is on Giannis not playing up to his contract this year?
So, like I said, I love it, and I'm gonna go with the same with mine, like a 5, maybe a 6, because it's not like he made it to the finals last year and lost.
Right.
We've now read this same book a few years in a row.
Exactly.
So it sort of seems on par. Had he been to the NBA finals last year and lost, and you were saying he was gonna take a step back, I would definitely go higher. But I mean, on the throes of a $40 million contract, you definitely need to be in the NBA finals this year, especially with the acquisition of Drew Holiday. Like, you have to be in the finals.
See, and that's even passing me up right there. Everybody was going nuts when Drew Holiday came over. And I totally agree, man. Totally agree that Giannis does have to get to the finals. For me, I'm going to push it up there maybe towards a 7 or 8, maybe even a 9, because I just know there's a lot of Giannis fanboys out there. I know there's a lot of people out there, and don't get me wrong, Giannis has absolutely earned all the recognition in the NBA. There is no question about that. You cannot be obviously an average guy and win back-to-back MVPs. I do think it was LeBron's last year, but I'm obviously not voting for the MVP. That's up to the other guys. But either way, man, it's going to be probably a 7 to a 9 for me. I'll probably stick it about a 7 or 8, just because I know a lot of people expect Giannis to come out, be more dominant. He's going to be working on the shot. Now he's got Drew Holiday, but I don't really see the Bucks getting to the title game this year. So I do think that is going to make him really underplay the worth of his contract. Guys, if you don't know about Prize Picks, it is literally the easiest way to play daily fantasy sports. And I just partnered with these guys. It's a super simple app. It's laid out. Check it out. All you got to do is pick 2 to 5 players in any sport, any league, any game, pick the over or under on their projected fantasy points, put it in as a power or a flex play. If you do a power play, you'll be able to cash them all in and win big money. But with a flex play, you can maybe have a couple fall through and you'll still get some of your money back or win partially on there. And the best part about this, guys, is if you use my code right here on the screen, offseason, OFFSZN, you can get your first $100 matched on your initial deposit. All you got to do is go download Prize Picks, use the promo code offseason, put you in some entries, and win some easy cash. I post every week about it a couple times a week. You can literally use my picks, guys. I'm literally telling you to go and make money right now. All you got to do is download the app and use the code. Back into the show here, guys. Tony, hit me with bold prediction number 2 for the 2021 NBA season.
Stan Van Gundy is going to coach up the youth in New Orleans, and the Pelicans will be the 8th seed in the playoffs this year. I'm a little worried because I don't know who the shooters are. I looked over the roster and I was just like, who? Like, but I think that they can make moves if they're competitive to get Van Gundy what he needs. But Van Gundy's a good defensive coach. The team will be pretty disciplined. If we can get health out of Zion, I think Ingram can continue to take steps forward. He wasn't really ever allowed to flourish out here in LA, and I think getting away from LeBron has really helped him.
Yeah.
And then I also like Lonzo and Bledsoe together on the floor at the same time. When I look at it, you have the luxury of Lonzo being 6'7" and being able to just sort of spread out and play defense. If he can fix the shot a little bit, the Pelicans get in. The 8 seed, they're going to get smoked in the first round by the Lakers.
Yeah.
It'll be 4-0. It'll be a quick one. But it'll be good experience for all of those young kids. And I've always thought that Van Gundy was an underrated coach, right?
I definitely agree with that there.
The rug was pulled out from under him in Miami a little prematurely there, in my opinion. But he's always been pretty good wherever he's gone. So I like the Pelicans to fill that void that the Rockets are going to that I'm predicting the Rockets will leave.
I absolutely love that, man. And honestly, if I had to give that on a scale of 1 to 10 for some boldness there, man, I'm going to say that's actually a pretty good take. That might be about maybe a 2 or 3 for me, because you look, they're, you know, getting rid of Alvin Gentry, bringing in Stan Van Gundy. I'm sure Zion's only going to be better. They obviously have ballers over there in New Orleans. This wasn't a terrible basketball team last year. They really underplayed in the bubble. I thought realistically, I remember it plain as day when I did my NBA bubble predictions. I said the Pelicans are probably going to go 6-2. Don't be surprised if they win more games than that. And I think they get the 8 seed. They absolutely bombed it out in the bubble. I want to say they went the exact opposite, 2-6, maybe 1-7, something like that. Absolutely bombed it in the bubble. But I do feel like they are going to come back this year. You look at the rookie Zion, who's hopefully going to be healthy, be able to play a full, not 82, but 72 games. And I'm going to love that, to see a guy like Zion, who's got so much hype around him, who's going to be able to come into the NBA. So I like that take, man. Probably about a 2 or 3 for me on the boldness scale. But where would you put it for the boldness?
That one for me is probably in the 4 maybe to 5 range, because right. Like I said, if I have the Rockets out and the Thunder out, who's going to fill those voids? It's probably right. Not Memphis. It's, you know,
walked into it perfectly.
But I do think after watching Zion play 33 minutes the other night, I didn't watch the whole game, but I went back and watched the highlights. He looks good, strong. He kept the weight off. He's moving really well. And he's going to be – we're going to see him a lot this year. The league is Zion our way. They really want this kid.
I want to talk about a coach here, man, for my second bold prediction that everybody wanted to blast when he got hired in the NBA. And the first thing I thought of was Steve Kerr 2.0. I'm talking about Steve Nash. I'm talking about those Brooklyn Nets. And my bold prediction is that Steve Nash will spearhead the Nets, much like Steve Kerr did with the Warriors. You look at two guys who are both point guards. It's two guys who are great passers, two guys who were great leaders, great shooters, guys who just all out balled and are very respectively top ranked in their positions, man. Everybody knows who Steve Kerr and Steve Nash are. And these guys were just dogs on the floor. And you look at the roster that's in Brooklyn now. Steve Nash has Kevin Durant, Spencer Dinwiddie, DeAndre Jordan, Kyrie Irving. He's got guys, Caris LeVert, guys at his disposal that he can make something happen with. I saw a bold prediction earlier today saying that maybe the Nets were going to finish as a 4 seed, or maybe not even as a top 4 seed in the Eastern Conference. I don't necessarily know about all the analytics and the actual, you know, roster play they're putting into that. Really just refreshing myself here coming into the new NBA season. But I don't see why Steve Nash could not spearhead the Nets just like Steve Kerr did with the Golden State Warriors. I'm not calling for a finals appearance. I'm not calling for a title. I'm not calling for any drastic run into the playoffs. But you want to talk about making this Brooklyn Nets team respectable and making them to where you don't overlook them on the schedule? 100% Steve Nash, man. You look at Steve Nash, man, he's arguably the best passer in NBA history. I mean, the way he could just go up for a layup and flip it behind his back, maybe through his legs, just so many no looks, really reminds me of Rondo would remind me of Steve Nash. Let's respect our elders here. But you look at Steve Nash, a guy who was just able to play so well in the NBA. And I really don't know how he couldn't have coaching success in the NBA. And as far as how bold that is, I feel like I maybe even want to put that on a 10 for how badly people were absolutely crapping on Steve Nash for getting hired. Everybody was talking about, the minority coach is not necessarily getting looked at in A, B, C, and D. And I necessarily get that. But why are we going to take that away from Steve Nash? Why are we going to take that away from a legend, a guy who was a true dog on the court, amazing vision? We know all about Steve Nash. He was a great shooter. Give him his props. Give him his respects. Steve Nash will spearhead the Brooklyn Nets a lot like Steve Kerr did with the Warriors. Tony, I want to hear your piece on it, man.
Real quick, touch on exactly what spearhead means. Tell me, are you predicting Eastern Conference Finals? Because that'll arrange my boldness. And then I also want to put a finer point on something you said about the Nash-Kerr comparison.
I got you. Absolutely. So when I say spearhead, yeah, maybe an Eastern Conference Finals. I feel like you're about to own me potentially. Maybe an Eastern Conference Finals appearance, but I definitely think he'll just make them a respectable team. You obviously got the newness in KD, him being healthy for this season. This is going to be his potentially breakout season. We might see a crazy version of Kevin Durant, or we could see a scaled back version. But I feel like maybe a better way to rephrase that is Steve Nash is going to become a respectable coach. People are maybe potentially going to eat their work. Words on what they said about Steve Nash becoming the coach for the Brooklyn Nets.
Okay. I love this. I love this take, right? Because I had a lot of the same people sort of in my personal circle saying Steve Nash has no coaching experience. Here's the thing. Former players that are great, that are naturally gifted, make bad coaches, bad personnel decisions. But when you have guys who overachieved, like Steve Kerr being in the NBA, having the career he had, and then Steve Nash not overachieving maybe beyond any other person, a two-time MVP, a guy who's like barely 6 foot, looks like he was in the band Hanson at one point with that old school haircut that he had.
There we go.
This dude overachieved, and he is so dedicated to the craft of basketball that I think that that is really going to rub off on a guy like Kyrie Irving. Kevin Durant is already a championship basketball player.
I picked
player,
the right guest for the show, man. You're throwing some heat out right now.
Kyrie needs somebody. And Kyrie came out the other day and said, hey, I want to take back my comment about us not having a coach. I don't know who pulled him aside and said, hey, man, you can't be saying stuff like that. We can't have you.
That shows dedication and leadership within the locker room and an organization to get your players right before you bring in a guy like Steve Nash.
Yeah, we can't have you coming out and talking about undermining Steve Nash as a coach, because he's already going to have enough expectations that he is coaching two-time finals MVP, two-time champion Kevin Durant on this team, and you champion with the Cavaliers. There are high expectations. For me, I have the Nets at least in the Eastern Conference Finals.
Love it, man. Love it.
And I really do think that people are going to say, oh, you know what? Steve Nash he's a great coach. He's a guy that can bring big personalities together because he knows basketball, but he also seems like a player's guy, a people person.
Exactly.
He's not going to be a huge ball buster. And for me, when you called him a dog out there, when you are that dedicated to it, you are successful. The Nets will be successful. If you would have said he's going to lead him to the finals, this would have been a 10 for me. On my boldest meter, I'm going to go with a solid 6, lean towards a 7 because of so many people bringing in just wondering what this hire meant. And to me, I always thought
people
this
crapped
was a
on
great
him, man.
Hire.
And I was so shocked to see that. I was like, really? Like, we're just going to act like Steve Nash isn't a legendary all time great? Like, come on, guys.
Yep, Larry Bird had success. He was another great player. And to
Larry
Bird was another guy who was in the NBA who was overachieving at a time where, like, he was playing against – when you're out there and you're playing against some of the greatest athletes on the planet.
Exactly.
And you are playing below the rim of a game that is played with the fastest, highest jumping people on the planet.
Right.
And you're out there schooling them like Larry Bird. The hit from French Lick is out there just balling people up, then you have some sort of dedication that can translate to coaching. Guys like Michael Jordan or LeBron or whatever, it so naturally comes to them.
Yeah, basketball runs through their veins.
It's hard to translate that to when somebody – you don't understand effort's not enough. Like, you're just like, oh, you can't just do this thing because you're not one of the most gifted people to ever touch a basketball.
Love it, man. Absolutely love their perspective there, man. I definitely picked the right guest to get on the show today. I love how we're literally just flowing in sync so well here on the Bold Predictions. Guys, today's episode is brought to you by Fanatics. Fanatics is the world's largest collection of official fan gear from all the leagues, teams, players, whoever you watch, whoever you love, whoever you're rooting for, they have gear and merch for you. If you enjoy the show, which I know you do, it's the most hyped sports podcast available, and you're looking to buy a new jersey, new merch, whatever the case may be, spoil yourself. It ain't even got to be for Christmas. You can support us by going to podgo.co/fanatics, spelling on the screen here for you, podgo.co/fanatics, FANATICS, and get 25% off your next order. That's podgo.co/fanatics, officially licensed everything. Gonna go ahead and tackle these last two bold predictions for the 2021 NBA season. Tony, go ahead and hit me with your last one before we wrap up today, man.
All right. I'm a big believer in addition by subtraction. And we saw the Boston Celtics go get Kyrie Irving, and everybody was like, oh, this is the piece we need. And what did they do? They were out in the second round.
Yep.
Last year, they went back to the Eastern Conference Finals, and they came up short.
Yep.
This is a twofer on the bold predictions, because not only do I have the Celtics winning the East this year, but I'm going to say that Jason Tatum is going to be the MVP. He's going to jump up to 38-5 on the stat line. Celtics will have the best record in the East. I think that we're going
38 points?
No, 30 points, 8 rebounds, 5 assists.
Oh, I say, whoa, that man is about to be balling.
38 points. Yeah, he's not even in the G League. I don't think he'd do that.
Right.
So the Celtics, to me, have great chemistry when you have the right ingredients on the floor at the same time.
Chemistry and culture, man. Some of the best in the NBA, no question.
Brad Stevens is great at sort of mixing it together when he's not trying to find minutes, find shooters, find lineup combinations. So when you can just have Kemba and Tatum and Smart and Brown rotating out, and then they went out and they got Tristan Thompson. Yep. And a lot of people bag on, and they say he's not good, he's not whatever. He's not great. He's not an all-star. But he works really hard on championship teams. He played some really good minutes for the Cavs teams that was on there. And it sort of gets overlooked because you were looking at Kyrie, Love, and LeBron. So on the Celtics team, he's going to give them good minutes. He's going to be able to bang with Bam a little bit. He's quick, so he can guard him away from the basket. He's the big, I think, the Celtics needed to sort of help get them. You know, he's different style player than Al Horford was. I think they've assembled the right combination. Tatum's going to take that next level, sort of really embrace that Mamba mentality, that killer will at the end of the game,
right,
and start making big shots. You know, Kemba's a wingman. We got a good 1-2 punch there. And then we got Smart and Brown doing dirty work, playing defense. I got the Celtics in the NBA Finals this year, Tatum as the MVP of the Eastern Conference.
How bold would you say those are, man? I love it.
To me, this is 8 breaking on 9.
I'm definitely going to have to be up there on probably about, I'd say maybe about a 7 or an 8 for the Celtics go into the NBA Finals and representing the East. Probably going to have to go on about an 8 or a 9 for Jason Tatum. I absolutely love what he's doing. You see a guy who kind of struggled early on in the NBA, but he's been able to improve really well, see the court better, just play overall better basketball in the NBA. And he's one of the great stars in this league right now, one of the best players for the Celtics. I absolutely love both of those takes there, man. It would be wild to see a team like the Celtics push past the Nets or push past the Bucks, but it's not necessarily out of the question. Let's not act like they weren't in the conference finals last year. Throw out the whole COVID season, you know, the whole COVID season, whatever that was. These guys were doing what they had to do. They wanted to play basketball and they wanted to play. They just wanted to go play ball and they wanted to make a shot at the chip. And the Celtics did a great job at that, obviously getting knocked out to the Heat, but love the take there, man. Really, really going bold here, guys. Obviously, that's the point of the episode. Bold predictions for the 2021 NBA season. This guy last year basically went 29-9-9. He's a young kid, super young, started playing professionally in his teens. With all those clues, you probably know who I'm talking about. It is Luka Doncic, the best young player in the NBA for the Dallas Mavericks. He's going to win the MVP next year. Luka Doncic is going to make a run. He's going to blow the doors off of the NBA. Maybe Kevin Durant doesn't come back and necessarily play great. Maybe LeBron James potentially maybe takes a step back. These are obviously all big ifs here. But Luka's been in the potential MVP conversation for a good bit now. I know it's only necessarily his third year coming into the NBA, but this is the best young player, the best young talent in the NBA. You look at a great owner like Mark Cuban. You look look at the culture that's in Dallas. This guy's potentially pushing for the Dirk type of clout, the Dirk recognition. You look at him being the foreign player, not obviously as big as Dirk, but this dude can ball. He can shoot. He could be a better three-point shooter, but we know the handles he's got. He can see the floor well. And I mean, honestly, is this guy really a rookie? I know he's 21 years old, but his professional career started in 2015. So he's been playing professionally since he was a teenager. We know about the Slovenian career and everything, but I love this bold prediction right here. I could definitely see Luka Doncic running, winning MVP at such a young age and only his third year in the NBA. It kind of makes you get those maybe Derrick Rose kind of vibes coming in real hot, obviously hoping we avoid the injuries, but winning it at such a young age and being just so dominant early on in your career with a great team like the Dallas Mavericks, who maybe could represent the West in a good way next year, maybe be in the finals. These Mavericks are coming. They're a hot team. I do have Luka Doncic winning the MVP next year in the 2021 NBA season. Tony, am I crazy or am I right about this, man?
You are crazy because the NBA MVPs are linked to the team's record.
Right.
So you're basically telling me that without a fully healthy Kristaps Porzingis, that somehow he's going to at least be sort of a top three seed in the West?
Yeah.
Like, this is this is a good
one. We're getting bold today, man.
Yes.
We're getting bold today.
Because I can't even remember. It's very rare occasion for them to give an MVP to a team that's not a front runner for winning the finals. And right. To me, the Mavericks, even though they played really well last year in the playoffs, they're not quite to that level yet.
Right. I think they lost 2 years away.
Yeah, they lost Seth Curry, which people aren't talking enough about what he did for the team last year coming off the bench.
Exactly.
So like the Luka saying that he's going to win MVP, the numbers are going to be outrageous.
Oh yeah. I mean, 29-9-9 last year, essentially, man. You look at it.
This is like, if I'm bold meter, like I'm like,
we breaking the meter.
I was going to say this, like I could see it happening. So I'm going to go 9, but I'm like searching for, you know, I'm looking for number 10 and it's like right there. It's like standing next to me in the face saying, how come you're not going to give me a 10? Like that's a bold, bold prediction.
Absolutely, man. I'm going to have to ride with about the 8 or the 9 train here on this, just because I've heard small talks about it. You know, people love to come in. They love to talk about the young guys that potentially could come in. And like I said, maybe with kind of the Derrick Rose formula there, obviously avoiding the injuries, but you know, youngest ever MVP. I want to say that still holds today. You see how he was able to absolutely dominate, winning rookie of the year, just being an all-out dog. People wanted to regard him as maybe one of the best, obviously before the injury. I'm not saying that Luka's potentially going to go down as one of the best, but you talk about how hard this kid's balling at such a young age. The guy's 21 years old and he's just now going into his third season. He's got a good culture around him. And like I said, with the kind of aura of Dirk looming around him, he knows being another foreign player for the Dallas Mavericks, probably having a good relationship with Mark Cuban. I would hope he would with a great businessman like that. I could definitely see Luka Doncic just coming out maybe, man, and just being such a dog and just on fire coming to win the MVP this year. I know you told me you had one that potentially would put us on 10, man. I want you to hit me with it before we get out of the episode today.
The Los Angeles Lakers and LeBron James push to go 64-8, right? So that would be because they're going to play a 72-game schedule. This would be LeBron's crown jewel in the Jordan argument, right? Is to have that one season that is a better winning percentage than the 72-10.
Right.
After thinking about it, I don't know that we're on a 10 level scale with this one.
Right.
But the idea that at age 36, he's going to lead a team to that sort of a winning percentage. And right. I think if it gets down to the final couple weeks of the season and they have 6-7 losses towards the end of the year and he could see that, I think we would see a very hungry LeBron James sort of chase down that number of that percentage number. Because he obviously can't get to the 72 wins because they're only playing 72 games. But this team, this Lakers team, is constructed to put up a lot of W's this year. And I think that would add to the LeBron, the King James documentary you know, the final throne or whatever it'll be called when we see it in 15 years on Netflix or whatever.
Honestly, if I had to put that on the boldness, man, I'd make it a 9 only because it's LeBron James and we've seen what LeBron's been able to do. I don't think this guy's going to slow down anytime soon. I'm really curious. Let me tell you what I'm most interested about. I feel like I'm most interested to see LeBron James's play, how great I almost know he's going to be after the age of 38 and potentially 39. LeBron James, I don't think is going to slow down anytime soon. And I'm in it, honestly, for the long ride. How long is he going to be able to keep up this MVP caliber type of play? And people want to say, oh, your age doesn't necessarily play into the whole MVP argument. The last time someone was kind of in the conversation this old and this late in their career was obviously Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. So we can't act like LeBron's not doing legendary things. He deserves the recognition. He absolutely should have had the MVP last year. That is going to wrap up today's episode of the What Offseason Sports Podcast, everybody. Guys, we gave you 6 bold predictions for the 2021 NBA season that's tipping off here in just a few days. I had my guy Tony Tucker here from Project Drivel on the show today, man. Thank you so much for coming. You can check out Tony on all social media pages. Check out his show as well on all podcast platforms. I'll throw the media here on the screen for you so you can see all of his handles. Of course, don't forget about the link tree and all of What Offseason social media's pages. That's every bit of content we are pushing out for you guys. Like, comment, and subscribe to the YouTube channel on this video. Everything about this video, engage with it if you don't mind, please, and thank you. As always, new episodes every Friday, guys, and this is What Offseason signing out, everybody.